Now, as you go back into the 1800s here, the early part of the record, there's not as many stations. And so some of this variability back in here is probably spurious because there's not such good averages back in those times. But even if you take this as the actual record, you can look at this and say, you know, get a pretty good idea as to what the natural variability is in temperature in Central Europe from year to year. And so you can see this is in degrees Celsius, and so you can see you can have changes of 2 or 3 degrees from one year to the next. In fact, they can occur quite abruptly from, say, here up to here, 3-degree change from one year to the next. And so how, given this record, can you possibly have a value this high in 2003? 2003 was a major heat wave and drought, I should say, in Europe at that time, and it led to over 30,000 deaths in an area that supposedly can cope. Well, here's how I think it happens. It's really because there's been a trend, and that trend exists especially since 1970, and then you have natural variability on top of that. So this is not caused by global warming, but it's not caused by natural variability either. In fact, it wouldn't happen without global warming. That's another way of expressing it. But this event, so in subsequent years, it's gone up and down, but it's now going up and down around a different level. And this is really the way to think about climate change. It's not that it's always going to be this high, but the risk of values like this are increasing as time goes on because of a background trend like this associated with global climate change. And this is the way to think about some of the other events that occur, including things like hurricanes. Let's now look at the extremes of temperature. Here I'm showing, this is the fifth or the 95th percentile. In other words, we're looking now at daily minimum temperatures, and we're going to look at maximum temperatures in a minute during the daytime. Cold nights are decreasing everywhere. And this is the overall global value in places where we've got data. There are some places we don't have data in Africa and South America. A little bit less in the eastern parts of the U.S., but still, cold nights are decreasing everywhere. Warm nights, this is the best statistic overall, are increasing everywhere, especially in Europe and Asia, a bit less in the eastern parts of the U.S. Here's the overall curve. Now, what happens when we look at the daytime? Here's the daytime. Cold days are decreasing most places, but not the eastern part of the United States. Cold warm days are increasing most places, especially in Europe and Asia, but not in the eastern parts of the United States and Argentina, and a little bit in southern Greenland, perhaps. Europeans are very convinced that global warming is going on. They've got reason to do so. Something special, something different is going on in these regions, however. I put these two together now. This is drought up here, the picture we saw before. This is the trend in warm days, and you'll see there's something in common related to these two regions here in Argentina and in the eastern parts of the United States. In other words, what has happened is that during daytime, there's more cloud, there's more rain. I showed you the statistics on rain before, precipitation. It's now, on average, about 7% wetter in this region than it was before 1970. Overall, what has happened in the past year is that this pattern's gone away. And suddenly, you've got drought in this region, in the southeast, and much higher temperatures can go along with that. And so, when you have what has happened and what is really going on here, and the things that these two regions have in common, there's two things they've got in common in particular. They're both east of a major north-south mountain range. So there's the Rockies here and the Andes down here. And they're both downstream from the tropical Pacific. And what has happened is a change in the phenomenon known as El Nino, that was mentioned before, and a change in the overall atmospheric circulation patterns across the Americas. It affects both hemispheres from the changes in the sea temperatures and the interactions with the atmosphere in the tropical Pacific. And so there's been a change in the storm tracks and the jet stream. And the jet stream is now, on average, a bit further south across the United States, bringing cloudier and wetter conditions as a whole than there used to be before, say, especially 1970. The models don't predict that particularly well. Where is the center of this? Maybe it's Huntsville, Alabama. I refer to it as the John Christie effect. Anyway, turn to hurricanes. We can go into this in considerable detail, but you know, this was Hurricane Katrina that made landfall near New Orleans, and the 2005 season broke all kinds of records in the North Atlantic. This is the actual record for the North Atlantic, showing you the hurricane record, the number of hurricanes down here with the gray bars, and the number of named storms in the orange bars up here. And then here's the corresponding sea surface temperature in the region where the main hurricanes form, from 10 to 20 degrees north. There's a low-frequency curve on here overall, which doesn't particularly match the data particularly well. Here's the 2005 season. It stands out with 28 named storms that particular year. There was one storm that was named after the season was over. And I just put the 2007 values on here, so there was 14 named storms and 6 hurricanes. Last year and this year, we were actually pretty close to normal. Last year, maybe slightly less than normal. This year, a little bit above normal. But in general, in recent times, there's been more activity, and there's also been higher sea temperatures. The highest sea temperatures on record in the tropical Atlantic, by far, occurred in 2005. There's a very clear relationship. When the sea temperatures are higher, there's more activity in the tropical Atlantic. In the tropical Atlantic this year, the last bar is not on here, but I think it's in the eastern part of the eastern central part of the Atlantic was actually very close to normal this past year. Only in the Caribbean and the western Atlantic was it a little bit above normal. So you can look at a spike back in here, and you can see that there's a spike in sea temperatures as well. The only cases where there was a spike in sea temperatures and there's not a corresponding spike in here are cases where there was an El Nino event, a major El Nino, and so all of the action shifted out into the Pacific, and then it creates an atmospheric circulation which makes it unfavorable for Atlantic hurricanes to occur. Only about 10% of the global hurricanes occur in the Atlantic. Most of the action is elsewhere in the Pacific. This year, most of the action was in the Indian Ocean, as it turns out. The most active year on record was 1997, which is actually this year here. It was a very low year in the Atlantic. And it was a year when sea temperatures were relatively high, but all of the action was out in the Pacific. So the most active year globally was actually a year where the Atlantic was not very active at all. The perspective you get by just looking at Atlantic hurricanes is not very meaningful in terms of global values or climate change. There's a lot of variability from year to year associated with El Nino, and there's also some lower frequency variability which we think is related to ocean currents and changes in the Gulf Stream and things like that.